Okay. Please listen. Now we are left with only exempted services and then service tax procedures. With that, service tax will be over. Today we will complete it. Page number 264. Page number 264. These are the remaining exemptions which is not covered in detailed analysis of services. You understood? Like how we have seen the balance in negative list, the same way this is balance in the exempted services. See that first one, services provided to United Nations or a specified international organization. This point already I have discussed with you. Any service provided to UN organizations are exempted, whatever may be that service. That could be any service. If it is provided to UN organization, it is exempted. Same way, specified international organizations like Indian Labour Organization, something like that. No, so these are specified international organizations which will also be getting some exemption. But how do we know, sir, it will be specified in exam that it is a specified international organization? Clear or not? Then look into the next exemption. Section 12AA of Income Tax Act deals with what? Trust, charitable trust. And any trust established for the purpose of charitable activities, if it gets any consideration, that consideration is exempted. First of all, the objective of the trust is to render services without collecting anything. That is what we call as charities. But nowadays, they will be collecting some amount, and that amount is taxable or not is our point of discussion. You understood or not? Generally, a charitable institution should not collect anything from the public for rendering the services. But sometimes they will be collecting some fees. Whether this is taxable or not, that we are going to see. If it is rendering charitable activities, and for that if it collects amount, it is exempted. Now we need to know what is the meaning of charitable activities. You understood? A trust rendering charitable activities for which a consideration is collected is exempted. Means we need to know what is the meaning of charitable activities. It is not a general definition of charitable activity, because general definition means everything will come in charity. So there are only specific activities given as charitable activities. Look into the first one. Charitable activities means activities relating to public health by way of whatever it is. Even if you do it not as a trust, it is exempted. Correct? All healthcare, even if you are not doing as a trust, is also exempted. Will you agree with me? A private hospital is also exempted. A clinical establishment, anything, if it is doing healthcare services, it is exempted. And even this is given in charitable activities. So you do not have to remember this specially. Simply remember healthcare services. Healthcare services. Okay, next. Advancement of religion or spirituality, comma yoga. What is it? Now all these stupid Babaji, Swamiji's are there, no? So they are exempted. How they are exempted? Under this. Advancement of religion, spirituality or yoga. Either they will be preaching about religion. Hinduism is this, Hinduism is that, it's great, all these things. We know here. We know every religion is special to that person who is born in that religion. Correct or not? Then spirituality, which really we cannot understand. And then yoga. It is recently inserted on account of that International Yoga Day. On account of that they have inserted this. Even imparting anything related to yoga. If you start teaching yoga and if you collect any amount, that is exempted. Clear or not? But all this should be in the name of charitable trust. This yoga is only for the sake of one person, Baba Ramdev. Got it? whatever the amount that he collects, because he, sir, by teaching yoga, what is it he will be getting? Don't tell like this here. By teaching yoga itself, he created a very big empire and he started manufacturing all products. You understood or not? He started with teaching yoga only, but only thing, he started teaching to celebrities. Okay, and the fees what he charge will be, no, the sky. That much amount he will be collecting. By making money from yoga itself, he started multiple ventures, so that amount completely is exempted. And all these people will never be doing in their personal name. No doubt they will be doing in the name of trust. Correct or not? You take any Swamiji, definitely he will not be doing in his name. It will be in the name of trust. Next. Point number 3. Advancement of, but actually I am against point number 2 here. Because they will be looting public money like anything. You don't know. They will be looting like anything. And why they need to be exempted? Am I right? Education can be exempted. Will you agree with me? You can be exempted. CA, you are attending coaching. Don't think that MTD care is being pinched by collecting 18% GST. Where from MTD care is having any botheration? MTD care do not have any problem because internet will collect it from the students. Correct? If it is increase in the income tax from 30% to 80%, it will definitely pinch the company. But when it is indirect tax, let it be 18 or 28 or 40% also, where from it will pay out of its pocket. It will only collect it from the students and it will pay to the government. You understood? Ultimately, who is getting affected? Students. So therefore, these and all should be exempted, not the stupid Babaji's and Swamiji's. Then, point number 3, advancement of educational programs of skill development relating to abandoned, orphaned or homeless children. Already I told you, orphanages are exempted. While discussing about education services, there we have come across one point, orphanages, running an orphanage. So orphanages are exempted. They are not required to pay any service tax on the consideration whatever they get. If at all they get any consideration on that, they are not required to pay service tax. Same way, abandoned, orphaned or homeless children. Next, physically or mentally abused and traumatized person. Can we bring CA students here? Logically, yes. Yes. Advancement of educational program to physically, mentally abused and traumatized person. I feel so. Yes. Then, prisoners. Persons over the age of 65 years residing in rural area. This point really I did not understand. He is crossing 65 years and what is the need of this advancement of educational program? If he is taught direct tax, definitely he will die. Okay, 65 years here, think about this situation. What is the need of education for him? I don't know. Okay, fine, that point is also given. Advancement of educational program or skill development to whom? People who crossing 65 years and where they should be residing in rural area. Let them die peacefully here. Preservation of environment including watershed, forest and wildlife. There are some NGOs which will be protecting the forest. And this Thiruvannamalai, there is one place called Thiruvannamalai in Tamil Nadu and which is having dense forest. That hill is completely surrounded by a dense forest. People who wanted this firewood and sandalwood, what they will be doing? They will be lighting fire in the forest. So therefore, they can easily get the firewood and that will be taken to another place. And there are some 2-3 NGOs, what they will be doing? They will be protecting the forest. You understood? They will be protecting the forest. So as and when they sense, because their job is to just look into the binoculars, and if they have seen some fire, immediately they will be owning a fire engine. So they will be taking it and they will put off that fire. You understood? So this is not done by government. This is done by some NGOs. Whether they are covered under the exemption, if they get any consideration, yes. Preservation of environment, including watershed, forest and wildlife. Suppose if it is any other activity apart from this, for which if there is a consideration, is it chargeable to service tax? Yes. I'll give you one information related to this as to when it is a charitable activity, but it is not exempted, it is taxable. If parents, if two people, husband and wife, if they need to adopt a child, because maybe they are not blessed with children, and if they need to adopt, they need to go through a specified NGO which is registered as trust. They need to make an application and they need to go to an orphanage and they need to select the kid that they wanted to adopt. This NGO will do the background verification of these two people. How many people are staying in their home and why they are not blessed with children? Because we cannot take some orphans, we cannot adopt some orphans and use them as labor. You understood or not? To prevent this, definitely they will be doing the background checking. And what is the financial status of these two people, whether they can take care of this kid or they will again desert him. You understood or not? All this verification is done by whom? That organization, that NGO, for which they will be collecting some fees also. From these parents, they will be collecting somewhere around 3,000 to 5,000 rupees. Is it a charitable activity? Yes, it is a charitable activity, but for a consideration. Is it chargeable to service tax? Yes, because it is no way given in the list of charitable activities. But by nature, it looks like charitable activity, but that is not given in this list. Hence, the consideration will be taxable. What if they have not collected any consideration? Then it is not a service. You understood? Then point number 5, service in relation to conduct of any religious ceremony. Who is covered under this category? All priests and purohits are covered under this category here, because they will only be conducting any religious ceremony. Got it? And whatever is the consideration that they collect will be exempted. It will not be chargeable to service tax. Sir, first they need to declare, right, sir? Yes, because they will not collect in account. Will you agree with me? They will never collect in account. Okay, sir, why should we bother? Anyhow, they will not be crossing 10 lakhs. No. Easily they will cross 10 lakhs in a year. That's a fact. Because the number of people into that profession has reduced over a span of time. And on the other hand, these religious ceremonies are increasing because nuclear families, many families are there now. So religious ceremonies are increasing. But the people who need to conduct this religious ceremony are decreasing. So automatically when supply is less, the price will increase. So they will be charging, I cannot say exorbitant price, but actually it is, yes, it's very big amount only. And this amount is not monthly once what they will be getting. It will be in a day, 2-3 things they will be doing. 2-3 ceremonies they will perform in a day. And maybe this season is a non-marriage season. Maybe this could be dry season for them. But thereafter, they will be making lots and lots of money. You understood or not? Now, 10 lakhs, crossing 10 lakhs will be like a cakewalk for them. It won't be a trouble. Sir, then why, sir, always they will look in such a way that they are not earning anything? It is their lifestyle. It is their lifestyle, so which makes them to live that way. You understood or not? So, but earnings, definitely they can. Now, what could be the majority of their consideration is from which way? Lot of religious ceremonies are there that they will be doing. But majority? Marriage. Because for all other religious ceremonies, what they collect is very less. For example, you know, some puja at home or some homam at home. For this, what they collect? Puja means not always that, idiot. Not always that. I'm not talking about your puja. Maybe morning problem you would be having. reason. Now, so this, for this what they collect is somewhere 10,000 to 15,000 or 20,000. But for one marriage ceremony, easily they will collect close to 1 lakh. Now, whether everything is exempted as per the line, you can say that everything is exempted. But what happened? One person filed a case in Delhi High Court stating that, sir, marriage is not a religious ceremony. Whatever the amount that these people are collecting, they are required to pay service tax. And Delhi High Court gave a judgment stating that, yes, marriage is not a religious ceremony. You understood? Marriage is not a religious ceremony. Why marriage is not a religious ceremony? Because there is nowhere in the religion scriptures that it is mentioned that marriage needs to be conducted in this way only. It is the customary practice. But it is not a religious ceremony. But even the opposite side is also there, that religion is not something which God has given to us. All customary practices, summation customary practices equals to religion. Got it? So therefore, where from it is not religious ceremony. So this debate is there, but Delhi High Court alone has given the judgment. Understood or not? Not Supreme Court. Which means? Come on, tell me. Marriage is religious ceremony as of now. If Supreme Court gives a decision stating that marriage is not a religious ceremony, then it is not. And whatever the amount that these people collect, they are required to pay service tax. But again, remember, what they collect is not in account. Okay? They will not be receiving in check or Paytm or credit card transfers and all will not be there. What they receive will be in cash. Okay? Then point number 5A. Services by a specified organization in respect of religious pilgrimage. Religious pilgrimage facilitated by the Ministry of External Affairs under bilateral agreement. What are called as religious pilgrimages? There are many religious pilgrimages, but everything is not given here. Only two are given. For Hindus, Kailash and Manasarovar Yatra pilgrimage. And for Muslims, Hajj or Umrah pilgrimage. Only these two are notified as religious pilgrimages for the purpose of exemption. You understood? What are the two pilgrimages which are notified as religious pilgrimage? Kailash Manasarovar pilgrimage, Hajj or Umrah pilgrimage. And these two should be conducted by who? Not by a private person, only by a specified organization. Then only it is exempted. You understood or not? So these two religious pilgrimages conducted by whom? Specified organization. And if they receive any amount, and they will come under tour operator service, correct or not? Whatever that amount is taxable or exempted? Exempted. What if it is done by a private person? Make my trip. First of all, they will not do. Suppose if they do, taxable. Then look into point number 17. That 7 is omitted. 17. Service by way of collecting or providing news by an independent journalist, Press Trust of India or United News of India. That is, generally there are some journalists who are no way connected to any media. And they are called as independent journalists. They will carry out the sting operations, or they will somehow collect the news, and that they will be selling to media, for which they will be paid some consideration. You understood? And this amount is exempted. Services by way of collecting or providing news by an independent journalist. Then Press Trust of India or United News of India. What is this? Generally, parliament proceedings cannot be recorded by any private TV channel. You know that? Only Doordarshan can do that recording. And suppose if a private news channel, for example, budget discussion, a private news channel want to telecast it, what they will do? They need to take it from Doordarshan and they will be paying some money. That's where you will be seeing, whenever they telecast the parliamentary proceedings that DD logo will appear, Doordarshan logo will appear and their TV channel logo will also appear. Or they will be putting courtesy from where they got this. You understood or not? So further they will be making payment and the one who receives it, it is exempted in their hands. Mainly, you know, at North, purely in Delhi, many people choose this journalism and social studies as their profession. There are many. Okay, but in South, no, there is no inclination towards journalism. But in North, if you see, many people will be going towards journalism. Okay, I don't know the reason, but that's a fact. Then point number 19, services provided in relation to serving of food or beverages by a restaurant, eating joint or a mess, other than those having a facility of air conditioning or central air heating in any part of the establishment at any time during the year. What is it? Already we have discussed it. AC restaurants are covered under service tax. AC, any AC. It could be centralized or non-centralized. That is split AC. Even if they keep one split AC, that will become an AC restaurant. You understood? It need not be centralized AC. But when they are using the word air heating, which is not at all applicable for Chennai, okay? Centralized air heating, maybe in somewhere in the extreme north it may be. So for that, it is centralized air heating, you understood? And these restaurants are chargeable to service tax, but other restaurants are exempted from service tax. But under GST, any restaurant is chargeable to GST. Now, they use the word at any part of the establishment at any time during the year. Now generally what will happen in a restaurant, there will be AC and non-AC. Two things will be there. One room they will construct as AC and normal some tables they will keep outside, that is non-AC. Have you seen?
Yes, sir.
Generally in hotels and restaurants you will be seeing this. Now, or somewhere in the first floor AC and in the ground floor it is non-AC. At any part of the establishment, if there is AC, entire establishment is chargeable to service tax. Clear? Because the words used are in any part of the establishment. Sir, is there any loophole? Yes. You should have multiple kitchens. You should have multiple kitchens. Okay. Even that loophole is equally applicable now. Because non-AC, it is how much? 12%. AC it is 18%. Now what if the food is in a common area? What if the food is in a common area and it is cooked from there and it is served in AC and non-AC? How can they escape, sir? Let them collect 18% from the public, but they will say that all the people sat only in non-AC. You understood? You understood or not what I mean to say? Kitchen is common, pa. AC, non-AC. From the people, they will collect how much? 18%. You understood? Then to the government, when they are filing return, they will say that everything is non-AC. How much they collected? How much they need to pay? You understood? This kind of manipulations will happen. And government has lot of work to do. They will not go to each and every restaurant and they will not count how many people in a day are eating in AC, how many people are eating in non-AC. You understood or not? Clear? And next thing. Sir, evidence is there. What evidence? The slip what they give up. For your information, that slip which is being given to you, after somewhere 1 month, there won't be anything on that slip. Have you observed? You take the bill, fold it and keep it in your purse. After 1 month you open and see, nothing will be there. Nothing will be there. What is the evidence there? You understood or not? Are they giving you a printed invoice for eating in a hotel? No. So it is always at their discretion to twist in any way. For the namesake, they will say in a month two people only sat in AC. But literally how much gain, you know, they will be making? 6%. Got it? Fine. Here, what is the loophole available? Multiple kitchens. Multiple kitchens means AC is taxable, non-AC is exempted. Correct? Now, if they have kitchen separately for AC and separately for non-AC, on AC, On AC, people who are coming and eating, on that only there will be service tax. On non-AC, there won't be any service tax. This is perfectly done by Hotel Sarana Bhavan. If you have visited any Hotel Sarana Bhavan, non-AC floor will be there. And kitchen. Actually, their business is that way. 75% will be dining. And the 25% will be kitchen. It will be like a rectangle. And in every floor, they will be having kitchen. And non-AC floor kitchen, food is served from non-AC only. AC floor, it will be served there only. Which means that they are maintaining two separate kitchens. And for identification purpose also, they will give a name for it. Have you identified? Yes, that is a name. Different name will be given. Some name, some different name will be given for that floor. So on so floor. And therefore, they are easily identifying the bills separately. So therefore, they can enjoy the exemption with respect to non-AC floor and they have to pay service tax with respect to the AC floor. You understood? At least for the namesake, if they will do any construction, they will construct this. Which Sangeeta, Hotel Sangeeta followed. In Hotel Sangeeta, same kitchen. But for the namesake, they will have one kitchen in the AC restaurant. They will also be having two things, AC, non-AC. But for namesake, they will have one kitchen. Because tomorrow, if anyone is coming for verification, they will say, sir, this is AC kitchen, this is non-AC kitchen. Clear or not? But of course, now they cannot do anything because anyhow, they need to pay service tax. Then point number 26, premium collected for certain general insurance services of government is exempted. Premium collected for certain general insurance schemes or policies of government is exempted. What are these general insurance schemes? You can see a big list of schemes are there. How to remember this, sir? You do not have to remember this big list. Instead, remember to whom these schemes are identified or to whom these schemes are designed. What is the vote bank for government? Vote bank. From where they will get votes? Huh? Not everyone. Agriculture and farmers. Correct? First vote bank. Below poverty line people. Women and infants. Even though infants is not having the vote right, but if you do something for infants, automatically you will get good votes. Then unemployed. Correct or not? Actually, this is the mass in India. Educated, least bothered. Why we need to do something for educated people? Correct. Why we need to do something for above poverty line people? This is the inclination of government. Reason? Anyhow, these people will not come to the vote booth and they will not cast their vote. They will find some reasons in non-casting their vote. But these people, no other work. Definitely, they will go to the polling booth and they will cast their vote. You understood or not? So, all these schemes of general insurance are designed for these people only. If you want, you check. Hut insurance scheme, to whom? Below poverty line people. Cattle insurance, agriculture and farmers. Scheme for insurance of tribals, below poverty line. Tribal will come under below poverty line. Janata personal accident policy and Grameen accident policy. This also for below poverty line. Group personal accident policy for self-employed women. This is for women. You understood or not? Like this, all these schemes are designed for these four people only. So now what you need to do in exam? They will give one policy. You need to check whether it is connected to these four people. If it is yes, no doubt it is exempted. Otherwise, it will be? Understood? Yes, sir. After class, we will discuss, sir. Huh? See, I speak practically. If you take it emotionally, it's not my mistake. Okay? And our friend is asking, sir, where from it is vote bank, sir? Definitely these people, really we need to do something for this. Who is denying that fact? I'm not denying that fact. But which idiot politician tell me who is doing something really for the deserved? No. every way, whenever they spend something, they will see whether we get some votes out of them or not. Correct or not? That's what I mean to say as vote bank. I never meant that we should not do anything for these people. Ayyayo, avlodha. People will kill me. Okay. I never said, again I am stressing, I never said that we should not do anything for these people. Again, I never said anything should be done for these people. Hello, video camera. I never said that we should not do anything for these people. வார்த்தை பேசுறது பயமா இருக்கு. 26A. The point 26 is related to general insurance. This is related to life insurance. And this is also by government. How to identify, sir, this is government life insurance? Very simple. In exam, they will give amount collected by government under so and so policy. Definitely that policy name will be having Yojana. Okay, Bima Yojana. No doubt that will be government's policy, not LIC. LIC will not come here. Janashri Bima Yojana, Aam Aadmi Bima Yojana, Varishtha Pension Bima Yojana, Pradhan Mantri Jeevan Jyoti Bima Yojana, Pradhan Mantri Jandan Yojana. You understood or not? All these are Yojana, Bojana and all. So this is exempted. Apart from this, micro life insurance. Micro life insurance is again one good interesting concept. This vendors, daily wage earners. Vendors means small vendors. Fruits, vegetables, flowers, etc. And daily wage earners. These people, if you ask them to pay any insurance premium, definitely they cannot understand this concept of insurance. So due to that reason, daily 10 rupees is collected from them. That is known as micro insurance. You understood or not? For example, if you pay monthly 2000 rupees as insurance premium, what is it per day? 2000 divided by 30.
66.6.
Correct only. So how much is collected? Anyhow, you are all paying how much? 60 rupees per day. What they will do, they will pay 10 rupees. That will not pinch them. But this 10 rupees every day when they start paying, that amount will become a very big money, some insured. And whenever, suppose if they die, to their family, that amount, some insured, will be given. Or upon maturity, they will collect that amount. You understood? That is known as micro insurance. All life micro insurance schemes approved by Insurance Regulatory Development Authority where the sum assured does not exceed 50,000 rupees. Okay. Then 26B, collection of contribution under Atal Pension Yojana. There is something called Atal Pension Yojana because government has removed pension scheme. You know that? When they removed the pension scheme, people cried that we need pension. For which government said, fine, we are giving pension to everyone. To everyone. Your government or private, wherever you are working, everyone is eligible for pension. And people did not understand what is the meaning of it. Then they have explained that we have developed a scheme called Atal Pension Yojana. Monthly you make contribution. It will be accumulated up to your retirement age. After that retirement age, whatever is the amount that you have contributed, one amount is there, on that interest will be given to you as pension. You understood? You got it?
Yes, sir.
Monthly I will contribute 2000 pa. This 2000 rupees for 25 years, how much it could be? Principal itself? 2000 into 12 into 25. 6 lakh. This is only principal, correct? Huh? But there will be reinvestment. First month principal will get accumulated for 25 years. Like that, it will get accumulated and the fund amount will become big. Say it may go to 12 lakhs. You understood? Principal is 6 lakhs. And there could be some 6 lakhs of interest also. Now, how much is the fund available? 12 lakhs. If the 12 lakhs is deposited in a bank at 10% rate of interest, what will be per annum?
1 lakh 20,000.
So monthly 10,000 rupees will be given to you as pension when after 25 years from now. Got it? You understood or not? That is known as this Atal Pension Yojana. And whatever the contribution that you are making, 2000 rupees, 2000 rupees, it is not treated as consideration in the hands of the government and it is exempted. Clear or not? Collection of contribution under Atal Pension Yojana is exempted. Then 26C, service of life insurance business provided by of annuity under National Pension Scheme. This is also the same one. This Atal Pension Yojana, another scheme is National Pension Scheme. Both are working on the same way. That is also exempted. Then point number 27. For explaining this point number 27, I wanted to discuss with you one movie, Dasavataram movie. Have you seen that movie? In that movie, in the introduction scene, they will be developing a biotechnology weapon. And the place where they develop that biotechnology weapon is known as incubate. Okay, incubator. The place is known as incubate. Incubate. That is a place where research will be carried out. And the person who owns it is known as incubator. That is a villain who has invested into that, who will try to sell the weapon to Russia and will realize the money. Have you seen a movie? You should remember some movies, okay? And there will be incubatee who will be providing services to the incubator. Our hero Kamal Haasan is incubatee. What he will be doing? He will be developing the weapon and he is rendering services to the incubator. Whatever the consideration that incubatee is receiving is exempted. Clear or not? So Kamal Haasan in that movie is exempt from payment of service tax. Services provided by an incubatee up to a total turnover of 50 lakhs. How much is exempted? 50 lakhs. Up to 50 lakhs in a financial year is exempted. For how many years this exemption can be availed? 3 years from the date of signing agreement. Please underline that. Second point. 3 years. 3 years from the date of entering into agreement. Only for 3 years this exemption is available. And one more condition. Previous year, the value of taxable services provided should not exceed 50 lakhs. Can you tell me this point? What is this? Services provided by incubatee to incubator up to 50 lakhs in a financial year is exempted, provided the value of taxable services during previous year should not exceed 50 lakhs. And this exemption is available for a period of 3 years from the date of signing agreement. Then, point number 29, certain intermediary services are exempted. That is, a sub-broker who is providing services to a stockbroker. Who is the stockbroker? One who purchases and sells securities on behalf of others is known as stockbroker. What is the benefit or consideration that a stockbroker will be getting? Brokerage. Brokerage. And sometimes the stockbroker may not be dealing with the people. He may appoint a sub-broker. And that sub-broker will be given some commission. Now, sub-broker is providing services to whom? Stockbroker. And stockbroker is providing services to whom? General public. You understood or not? Which service is exempted here? Stockbroker service or sub-broker service? Sub-broker service is only exempted, but not stockbroker service. Okay, so write down there. Stockbroker service is taxable. Stockbroker service is taxable. Why they have given this exemption? Because anyhow on the complete brokerage, who is paying service tax? Stockbroker. Out of that brokerage only, he will give a part to the sub-broker. Do you remember distributor selling agent concept? From organizer, distributor will get commission. Out of that commission only, he will pay to the selling agent. What is the need of making two people pay service tax? That's why here also the same way, stockbroker will receive brokerage. In that brokerage, a part will be shared with sub-broker. Now, if you tax both of them, then credit, all these things will come. Due to that reason, sub-broker is exempted. Only stockbroker has to pay service tax on the brokerage what he receives. Clear or not? Authorized person to member of a commodity exchange. Like how we have stock exchange, we also have commodity exchange. A stock exchange is a place where securities are bought and sold. Commodity exchange is a place where commodities. What are commodities here? Everything that could be, you know, commercial goods or that could be essential goods. Rice is one commodity, correct or not? Cotton is one commodity. Pepper is one commodity. Cashew nuts is one commodity. Red chilies is one commodity. Got it? So like this, the commodity exchange is there. In that commodity exchange, if any person is acting as an intermediary, he is also exempted. From what? From paying service tax on the commission what he receives. Then, this point number 29H, you see, subcontractor providing service by way of works contract to another contractor providing works contract service which are exempt. What is it, sir? I'll give you an example, just remember that example enough. Tamil Nadu government started metro rail project. This metro rail project has been given to L&T. L&T is the contractor who is providing works contract services to Tamil Nadu government in relation to construction of metro rail, which is exempted. Which is exempted. Now, L&T will outsource some works to another subcontractor. Possible? Not L&T will do everything. They might outsource it to some other contractor. Now, if the main contractor is exempted, subcontractor is also exempted. Now you read this, you will understand. Okay, so subcontractor providing services to a works contractor who is providing a works contract which is exempt. That is also exempted. Then, point number 30, it is related to job work. It is related to job work. So related to this, you need to make note of some information in your notebook. So please take your notebook and give a heading. Job work under excise and service tax. Job work under excise and service tax. Next time, if I see you talking, no, you talk. That's okay. No, when class is going on, I said you should not talk. Okay? Clear? The deal is deal. I asked you not to talk when I am taking class. But when you are writing, okay, fine. That's okay. You have to. I cannot restrict you. Job work under excise and service tax. Listen, you are doing some job work. Means you are not the manufacturer actually. Someone gave you goods, you manufacture it and you return to them. That is what job work is. Correct or not?
Yes, sir.
Carrying out some production process on behalf of others is known as job work. Carrying out some production process on behalf of others is known as job work. Now, what is that manufacturing activity that you are doing? Whether it amounts to manufacture or it does not amount to manufacture under section 2F, we need to know. If it amounts to manufacture under section 2 clause F of Central Excise Act 1944, if it does not amount to manufacture under section 2F of Central Excise Act 1944, I'll give you an example. You are a job worker and you are good at painting a product, okay? I gave you the product to be painted. You did the painting work and you returned me. Clear? Now tell me, is it job work first? Yes, it is job work. You are doing some work on behalf of me. It is job work. Now, whether the activity what you have done amounts to manufacture under section 2F? No. Because no new product is coming into existence which serves a different purpose than that of the existing product. Correct or not?
Yes, sir.
It does not amount to manufacture. That will come under this category. Suppose if I give you wood to make a chair and you return me the chair. Now, this is job work or not?
Yes.
Whether this activity amounts to manufacture under section 2F?
Yes.
Clear? Now, when it amounts to manufacture under section 2F of Excise Act, we need to know what is the nature of goods. I am dividing it into three. OPM, comma narcotic drugs. OPM, comma narcotic drugs. Alcohol and other goods. OPM, comma narcotic drugs, alcohol and other goods. Now listen. In case of OPM and narcotic drugs, I discussed with you along with excise, central excise, telling you that in case of three goods, state government will collect excise duty. What are those three goods? Opium, alcohol and narcotic drugs. So in this case, what is payable? State excise duty is payable. Correct or not? State excise duty is payable. State excise duty is payable. Then, job worker collects some job charges. Am I right? Job worker collects some job charges. Whether that job charges are taxable or exempted? Exempted. Why? Because entire levy of state excise duty is there on those goods. Correct or not? Which means, what is the need of collecting service tax on the job charges? So job charges are exempted from service tax. Clear or not? Job charges are exempted from service tax. Sorry. Job charges are non-taxable because it is given in the negative list. Non-taxable under service tax. Job charges are non-taxable under service tax because that entire product is covered under state excise duty. When it is covered under state excise duty, job charges is also part of the goods. Correct or not? On that specially, no need to collect service tax. It is non-taxable. What about alcohol? Again, same. State excise duty is payable. What about job charges? That job charges is chargeable to service tax. You understood? Job charges is chargeable to service tax means central government wanted to see some revenue in this. Got it? So what they did, they made job charges are chargeable to service tax. You understood? Means if you are undertaking job work in relation to manufacture of alcohol, on alcohol, what duty is payable? State excise duty. Who will pay? Either you will pay and in turn recover it from the owner of that goods. Correct or not? Or let the owner of the goods pay state excise duty. But what you get is job charges for manufacturing alcohol. You understood? On those job charges, whether you are required to pay service tax? Yes. Yes. This is where the conflict came between state government and central government. Because state government is not supposed to collect service tax. And central government is not supposed to collect state excise duty. Will you agree with me? And some products which are reserved for state government is this alcohol, opium and narcotic drugs. Why central government is entering into that area is a question of the state governments. Got it? Sir, now under GST, how it is dealt? They did not deal with this. They have excluded it from the GST. Under GST, alcohol is not covered. Means still excise duty, still service tax? Yes. Still excise duty, still service tax, the same thing is there. It is excluded from GST. Because they don't want to deal with that, so they want to give complete benefit to the state governments only. Even state governments has requested so that they want alcohol outside the ambit of GST. That's why it has been excluded. Okay, but maybe in future it will be included. As on today, it is excluded. Other goods, in case of other goods, what is it you need to pay? Central excise duties payable. Whether job charges are non-taxable? Yes. Central excise duty is payable. Yes, sir. The doubt get up. Okay, having asked, let me give you. Pondicherry and Delhi are not union territories, are not union territories. They are called as union territories with partial statehood, which means it is as good as a state government. As good as a state government, separate state. It will be read as state. And inside Pondicherry, if there is any transaction that has taken place, like how Tamil Nadu pays, the same way even Pondicherry has to pay. Totally there are 7 union territories. In that, 2 are given the statehood, partial statehood. Means like state only we have to treat. Okay. So now in Pondicherry, when alcohol is being manufactured, they need to pay state excise duty. But there is no concept of state excise duty because it is a union territory, correct or not? So that's why they will pay something as state excise duty, but it will not go to Tamil Nadu state. It will go to whom? Pondicherry. But Pondicherry is not a state. It is under whose control? Central government. So this amount will go to central government. What central government did? Okay, what is the excise duty that is being levied by Tamil Nadu government? They are levying somewhere 18%. Okay, fine. I will levy 2%. You understood? Central government is levying how much? 2%. If it is 2%, automatically what will happen to the price of the alcohol in Pondicherry? Got it? This is the reason why the prices of alcohol in Pondicherry is less. Clear? Experience, sir. What obviously? No air? No. For your information, none of the faculty of MTED Care, again I am repeating, is having any bad habits. None of them. So we do not drink, we do not smoke. Clear? Enna sonna? Nee vandu paathiya? This. Okay, none of the existing faculties of MTED Care. Then see this, whether job charges are taxable or non-taxable, job charges are non-taxable under service tax. What if the activity does not amount to manufacture under section 2 clause F? Then on job charges we need to pay service tax. But here we have a classification. Specified process and other process. If it is other process, then job charges are exempted, not non-taxable, it is exempted from service tax. What if it is specified process? Taxable under service tax, if it is specified process, then job charges are exempted from service tax. It is because of this person only I am doing mistakes. Hey, stop asking me doubts here, please. If you ask any reasonable doubt, it is okay. So, if it is specified process, it is exempted. If it is other process, it is taxable. What are those specified process? You understood this chart? First, if it amounts to manufacture under section 2F, either there will be state excise duty or central excise duty. Because there is state excise duty or central excise duty, job charges is non-taxable under service tax. But the exception is alcohol. Even though there is state excise duty, on job charges we need to pay service tax. Then, if the process does not amount to manufacture under section 2F, there is neither central excise duty nor state excise duty. Correct or not? So, in some tax should be collected. That's why the job charges are chargeable to service tax. But we have some specified process which are exempted. Clear or not? Now, what are those specified process which are exempted? Write down below. Specified process which are exempted. Specified process which are exempted. Number one, agriculture, already we have discussed it. Carrying out intermediate production process in relation to agriculture on job work basis. Number two, printing means all printing press are exempted from payment of service tax if the activity does not amount to manufacture. Number three, textile processing, not weaving, coloring or dyeing. Because weaving means you are bringing into existence a new product that amounts to manufacture, but it will come under which category? Process does not amount to manufacture. Means dyeing or coloring is not a process which amounts to manufacture, because already there is a garment in existence. When you do coloring or dyeing, you are increasing the value, but you are not bringing into existence a new product. So whether that process is covered under the second heading? Yes. And is it specified process? Yes. So therefore no need to pay service tax, it is exempted. Next, number four, this jewelry, job work in relation to jewelry. Because anyhow, the manufacturer of jewelry is paying excise duty on jewelry, correct or not? So why we need to torture the job worker from payment of excise duty? So job worker is exempted under excise duty. In which case, under excise we have seen this. Under excise, a person who manufactures jewelry is required to pay excise duty. So their job worker is anyhow not covered. What about some activities in jewelry which do not amount to manufacture? Example, removing the old stones and inserting the new stones, is a manufacture of jewelry or some process which do not amount to manufacture? Will you agree with me? Because jewelry, for example, you take a necklace. For the name it is diamond necklace. But actually, whatever is there studded is not diamonds. These are synthetic stones. Synthetic stones made out of plastic. You got it? Because when you go to a shop and when you see one necklace, a beautiful necklace, when you ask for the price, they will weigh it and depending upon the grams, they will ask you to pay. But they will not ask you to pay even 1 rupee for the diamonds. Not even 1 rupee, only for the gold you need to pay. Mean diamonds are free if you buy gold? No. What is there inside is not diamonds. These are called as synthetic stones. If you give 5 rupees, you will get one stone. Got it? You understood? So these stones will, now like the glow or the attraction of these stones will come down gradually. At that time, what people will do, they will take this necklace again to that person and that person will remove that stones, old stones, and the new stones he will attach it to that jewelry and again it will get the same glory. Got it? You understood or not? These stones are not diamonds, not precious stones, because if you see a necklace which is having some 20 diamonds in it, really if it is diamond, then the value of gold will be 1% of the total value of that necklace. You understood? Clear or not?
Yes, sir.
Sir, gold is costlier or diamond is costlier? Diamond is only costlier. Diamond is only costlier. A diamond necklace, really if you are paying for gold, that will be only 1%. Really if it is a diamond necklace. Clear or not? Sir, then Kalyan Jewelers, they are giving at 10,000 rupees, sir, one diamond necklace. One diamond chain, they are giving at 5,000 rupees, sir. That's what I mean to say. That is not, first of all, diamond. Clear? Then, number 5. You understood what kind of work will come under this category? That is doing some activity on jewelry that does not amount to manufacture. Then next thing, like polishing. Polishing the jewelry. So polishing the jewelry also does not mean bringing into existence a new jewelry. Correct or not? So all these are process which does not amount to manufacture. And you can claim exemption because it is given in that specified process. Then, next is process in relation to manufacture of, process in relation to manufacture of cycles or sewing machines. Parts of. Process in relation to manufacture of parts of cycles or sewing machines. What is this? Sewing machines. Stitching machines. Cycles? You know, normal cycles. Where the aggregate turnover in a financial year does not exceed 150 lakhs. These are the 5 processes which are specified, and if you do this, if you collect any job charges, it is exempted. What about excise duty? First of all, excise duty will not come here because these processes do not amount to manufacture. Okay, you understood this? Then look into point number 31. This point number 30 is over. Refer notes. So this you can skip and you can refer to your notes. Then point number 31, services by an organizer to any person in respect of business exhibition held outside India. Where SP is in India, where SR is in India, but where exhibition is held outside India. What is the purpose of this exhibition?
Sale
to encourage exports, correct or not? Only when you display a product in an exhibition held outside India, the foreign buyer will come to know about that product and he will place an order and you can do export. Means indirectly it leads to exports, correct or not? Even though both SP and SR, if both SP and SR are in India, both are in taxable territory, is it a taxable service or not? Yes. But it leads to exports, due to that reason it got exemption. Understood? That is, one organizer of an event who is in India, the service recipient is also in India, and it is in relation to what amount is collected for what purpose, to exhibit a product in an exhibition which is held outside India. For that, whatever is the consideration received is exempted. Then point number 33, services by way of slaughtering of animals. Slaughtering, that is, previously bovine was given, but now it need not be bovine, any animal. Means bovine means which is domesticated, like goat, pig, etc. That is, but now any animal is covered. What is this slaughtering? There are some slaughter houses which will kill the animal and which will remove its skin, will take the flesh out, and they will give that flesh. And it is not sale of meat. It is a work wherein you will give the animal to them. They will carry out the killing process, slaughtering, etc. And then they will give the meat to you, for which they will collect some amount as some job charges. That is exempted. They do not have to pay even 1 rupee as service tax. You understood? What is the activity here? Slaughtering. What is the consideration? Some charges. Whether it is exempted or taxable? Exempted. And so I don't know the reason for this exemption really here. Because if it is bovine animals, I do agree. Fine. Because it is for food. But all type of animals, of course, that is also for food only. But if it is sheep, goat, or to some extent even pig, fine. And cow slaughtering is also covered. Cow slaughtering, even camel slaughtering, you understood? Camel slaughtering, yes, yes, it is there. Not something which is new, camel slaughtering is also there. All these are now covered under exemption. I really don't know what is the meaning of this exemption, because don't expect that the people who are doing this will cross 10 lakhs of turnover in a year. Their job charges and all will not cross 10 lakhs. Anyhow, they can claim SSP exemption. Then point number 34. This is a meaningless point. Services received from a provider of service located in non-taxable territory by a person located in non-taxable territory. If both are located in non-taxable territory, it is a non-taxable service. No need to give it in exemption. So you can write either as exemption or non-taxable, the answer will be same for this. Next, point number 35. In olden days, there used to be a place called library where people will go, will take the books on rent and will be paying some rental charges. Whether that rental charges is exempted or taxable? Exempted. Service of public libraries by way of lending of books, publications, or any other knowledge enhancing content or material. Got it? But only public libraries are covered under the exemption. What are private libraries then? The entry is not open to everyone. That is known as a private library. Only to group of people. Example, ICAI is also having a library. But it is only for students of ICAI. Correct or not? And will they charge any rent? Free, yeah? But you have to read there only, no? Suppose if they charge a rent wherein you can take the book to your house and you can read and you can give it back, in that case, that rent is taxable or exempted? Taxable. But actually, it is exempted in another place. Tell me where. Services provided by an educational institution to students, faculty, and staff. Do you remember? Under that category, it will get exemption. That. Services. What if MTD care is doing it? It will not come in education institution. So that exemption is not there. Again, here it is not a public library. So this exemption also will not be there, and it will be chargeable to service tax. Then point number 36, services by employee state insurance corporation to persons covered. Just remember ESIC, if this employee state insurance corporation receives any amount, who will pay? The employer will pay for their employees an insurance, that is known as employee state insurance. Clear up? An employer pays insurance on the life of their employees who are working in the factory. That insurance is known as ESI, employee state insurance. To which organization they will pay? Employee state insurance corporation. Whether this payment made is taxable or exempted in the hands of ESIC, it is exempted in the hands of ESIC. Then point number 37, services by way of transfer of going concern as a whole or an independent part thereof. What is this? Slump sale. Slump sale. Whether capital gains is over?
No.
No. Started. In capital gains, you will be coming across something called slump sale. Transfer of business as such. Not transfer of assets in the business. Transfer of business as a going concern. That is known as slump sale. And this transfer of business as a going concern will not come under the meaning of goods. You understood or not?
Yes,
will not come under the meaning of goods. Okay, will it come under the meaning of service? That is also no. On a safer side, they are excluding from the service tax by giving an exemption. Because if it is not goods, what could be the interpretation? It might become service. You understood or not? If it might become service, then service tax is possible. That's why to avoid that, what they are telling, slump sale, any consideration received in a slump sale is exempted under service tax. Clear or not? What is slump? S-L-U-M-P, sale. Slump sale means what? Transfer of a business as a going concern is known as slump sale. Okay? Then point number 38. Generally, now there will be some public toilets where 1 rupee or 2 rupees will be collected for using urinals or lavatory. Whether this 1 rupee or 2 rupees is taxable? No. It is exempted under point number 38. But sir, they will not cross 10 lakhs. If they cross 10 lakhs, I will quit teaching today. I will start 4 toilets. Okay. 10 lakhs into 4, 40 lakhs. See the turnover. In that, what will be the expenses? Rent I have to pay. And for the people who are sitting there, I have to pay and cleaning. All these could be somewhere 30 to 40% only overhead cost. So 40 lakhs, 40% means 16 lakhs will go, but balance completely will come 24 lakhs into my pocket. Correct or not? That too it is exempted. Service tax, no need to pay. You understood? 24 lakhs, when I should earn, how many hours I need to stand by taking classes, there happily I will sit. Only thing, I will encourage the people, go and use the toilet. Come on, go and use the toilet. And marketing I will do properly. Use toilet, stay in heaven, like that. So, automatically my business will increase. But, sad truth that it will not cross 10 lakhs and all. Service by way of public conveniences such as provision of facilities of bathroom, washrooms, lavatories, urinal or toilets. Exempted. Not toilet is exempted. The money what you pay is exempted. Then, see this, point number 41. Any service provided to RBI is taxable or exempted? Services provided to RBI taxable. By RBI is non-taxable. Non-taxable. Now, services are provided to RBI by a person outside India. Listen. Services are provided by a person outside India to RBI in relation to managing the external foreign reserves. Got it? External foreign reserves means the service is in relation to converting the dollars or rupees into Indian dollars into rupees or rupees into dollars, like that conversion, which is done from outside India. To whom they are providing the service? To RBI. Generally, in case of import of service, who is liable to pay service tax? The importer is liable to pay service tax, correct or not? Being RBI, they have given the exemption. Read this. Specialized financial service received by RBI from outside India, means RBI service provider or service recipient? Service recipient in the course of management of foreign exchange reserves is exempted. Then, point number 42, already we have discussed. Under tour operator, Indian tour operator providing tour operator service to a person outside India, completely in relation to a foreign tour. Then, services by operator of common effluent treatment plant by way of treatment of effluent, that is septic tank cleaners. There will be a tank called septic tank wherein all your waste will get stored. That needs to be cleaned from time to time. And for cleaning it, you cannot do that. So you will ask one person to clean that septic tank. And these people will be charging some amount and they will clean it. And this amount is exempted. That is this common effluent. Clear or not? Correct or not? The effluent which is common to anyone. What is that? You know. Then point number 46. Services provided by way of exhibition of a movie by an exhibitor to the distributor or an association of person consisting the exhibitor as one of its members. Listen. A producer has invested some crores and he got a movie. Okay, he got a movie. Movie is ready with him. How he can sell it? Either the people who acted in that movie should be having the credibility so that the movie will get sold on itself. If Ajit or Vijay or Rajinikant or Kamal Haasan, if they are acting like me, some stars are acting in that movie, it will get sold. What if Santanam is acting in that movie? You understood or not? Santanam, you know, right? What if he is acting in that movie? It needs to be sold. It will not sell on its own. So what producer will do? He will ask all the distributors to come for one benefit show. Benefit show or a privilege show. And he will book a theater. He will book a theater for one day. And all these celebrities who are acting in that, who has acted in that movie, and some chief guests and distributors, all these people will be called. And the movie will be played. So distributors will come to know the effect of that movie. Okay, whether it can recover money or will not recover money. And based on that, the distributors will make payment to the producers and will buy the right to distribute in a particular region. You understood or not? For this, the producer is paying some amount to the theater owner for booking the theater for one complete day. You understood or not? Whether this rent is taxable or exempted in the hands of theater owner, it is exempted. That is his point. Services provided by way of exhibition of a movie. Who will do this exhibition of a movie? Theater owner. Exhibition of a movie by an exhibitor. Who is this exhibitor? Theater owner, not producer. He will not exhibit the movie. He has the movie. He cannot exhibit it. You understood or not? Clear up, huh? Yes, he cannot put it in his laptop and show to everyone. Not possible. It needs to be exhibited. Even he cannot put a projector and he cannot telecast. So because he need to show only in a theater to get the theater experience. So exhibitor here is theater owner, but not the producer. To the distributor or an association of person consisting exhibitor as one of its members, because sometimes the theater owners themselves will become distributors. You understood? Example, Satyam Cinemas. Satyam Cinemas, they have many theaters under their control. You understood? So they are one distributor. Directly they will buy from the producer. They will not get it from a distributor, because they need to pay again commission to the distributor, and directly they will deal with producer so that they can eliminate the middleman and they will become distributor. So whomsoever is having more number of theaters, automatically they will become distributor. You understood or not? So therefore, this is an association of person consisting this theater owner as one of its members. You understood or not? And whatever is the rent that is collected, from whom they will collect rent? Producer. From whom they will collect rent? Producer. That is exempted. Next, last point. These specified organizations, IRDA stands for Insurance Regulatory and Development Authority. SEBI stands for Securities and Exchange Board of India. EPFO, Employee Provident Fund Organization. NCCCD, that is National Center for Coal Chain Development. National Center for Coal Chain Development. If these four organizations receives any money for rendering services, that will be exempted. Clear or not? SEBI will receive some fees as compliance fees or filing fees. Whether it is exempted? Yes, like that. If these organizations receive any amount for rendering their services, that amount is exempted. So with this, exemptions are over and abatement reverse charge mechanism we have completed. Now look into some specified activities and you need to answer whether it is taxable or non-taxable or exempted. See the first one, page number 272. Manufacture of exempted goods under excise. Taxable or exempted or non-taxable? Manufacture of exempted goods under excise means it is covered under the levy of excise. Correct or not? Means this activity is exempted under service tax. Why? Because it is already, it is non-taxable. Non-taxable, already covered under excise. It is already covered under excise. Then the job charges is, non-taxable. If it is alcohol, taxable. Manufacture of dutiable goods under excise means it is already covered under excise. Then under service tax, it is non-taxable. Manufacture of non-excisable goods. Listen carefully. Non-excisable goods means it is not covered under excise. Means on job charges, there will be service tax. But if it is specified process, it is exempted. Is it given that it is specified process? No. Which means it is taxable. Job work on goods on which duty is paid by principal manufacturer means is it covered under excise? Yes. That's why duty is paid by principal manufacturer. When it is covered under excise, it is non-taxable under service tax. Job work on goods on which no duty is payable by principal manufacturer due to exemption means it is covered under the levy of excise. Yes. Means when it is covered under the levy of excise, under service tax, it is non-taxable. Manufacture of alcohol or wine, even though it is covered under excise, but it will be taxable under service tax. Job work of printing, exempted. See, if it is covered under excise, no doubt it is non-taxable. If it is not covered under excise, it is in the specified process, therefore it is exempted. Textile processing. Manufacture of medicines containing alcohol. What duty we need to pay? Central excise duty. Means under service tax, it is non-taxable. Okay. All these are related to job work. Next. Entry ticket sold for holding a dance program. Exempted or taxable? Exempted, I told you. Dance shows are exempted irrespective of the ticket price. But music performance? Exempted only if the entry ticket is less than 500. If it is greater than 500, then it will be taxable entirely. Here it is. Dance program, no limit on the entry ticket. Exempted. Collections from standalone rides set up in a mall. So in a mall they will set up a ride. Okay. So that will be taxable. Nowhere we have seen any exemption for that. Running a video parlor showing cinematograph films. What is this video parlor? small theater which will have a capacity of 50 people. Okay, and listen, not like it will be like a theater wherein one movie means they will play only that movie. It's like multiplex model. Multiplex model means in a single screen they can show 3-4 movies also. Correct? Sir, have you been to any multiplex? Definitely you have to go to multiplex only. No other go in Chennai. If you go to any multiplex, let it be Escape or PVR Cinemas, etc. In that screen, only one movie will be played?
No, sir.
No. Maybe on the release day they will play. But thereafter, they will restrict the shows. Only one morning show or one night show.
Yes,
and somewhere in the middle, in the same screen, they will play some other movie. Correct or not? Exactly the same video parlors will also run. These video parlors will have a limited seating capacity and they will play multiple movies in a day. You understood? They will play multiple movies in a day so that they will generate some good revenue. You understood or not? What is the need for this? These video parlors are in the place where really the, no, like theaters are not there. Theaters are not there. And it is not that developed place also. It is like a village or it is like a town, rural place, extreme remote places. And that to the concept of video parlors you will not be seeing in South India. Only in North India you will be seeing this concept of video parlors. Because in North India there are many villages compared to South India. In South India, even if it is a village, but there will be cinema theater. Because we like that entertainment. Because we know that is the only entertainment for us. So therefore, the cinema theaters will be constructed in every place. Let it be village or town, everywhere it is there. But in north, in some places like remote places or rural places, there will be a concept of video parlors. They cannot afford to have a cinema theater. So there, if any amount is collected as the entry ticket, is it taxable or is it exempted? Because if you see, the entry tickets when I have discussed, I discussed this point that exhibition of a film is exempted. Did I specify that exhibition of film should be in a cinema theater?
No, sir.
See here, exhibition of a film, should it be in a cinema theater?
No,
exhibition of a film. That could be in a cinema theater or that could be in a video parlor. Whatever is the entry ticket that is collected, which will be, come on, exempted. Video parlor services rendered inside, not related to admission. What is it? Taxable. Example, sale of food inside the video parlor. That will be taxable?
Yes.
Only entry ticket is exempted. Video production agency or videotape production service. We have never seen this anywhere, correct or not? Which means? Okay. So an exam, very simple. You have attended all the classes. Have that confidence. I have attended all classes of service tax. When I see something new, it is taxable. Clear, appa? When you read something and if you feel like it got discussed in the class, either it will be exempted or non-taxable. You understood? Clear?
Yes, sir.
Then, acting as an event manager for organization of an entertainment event. Anywhere we have discussed about this? Taxable. Is it from running a circus? Because for every, a circus exempted, entry ticket is exempted. Because for everything we have discussed, exemptions and negative lists in detail we have discussed. So if it appears like we have discussed, you have to write that. Either exempt or non-taxable. Otherwise taxable. DTH. Distribution of electricity by developer or housing society. I told you, electricity is not covered under service tax. Non-taxable, covered under negative list. Installation of gensets by private contractors for power supply, taxable, that will not come under electricity. Hiring of electricity meter by electricity distributor, is it part of electricity service? Non-taxable. What about security deposit? You know that security deposit? EB will be collecting something called security deposit. What is that security deposit? Average of your monthly bills. Average of your monthly bills will be collected as security deposit. For example, on an average, your monthly bill for last 6 months is 9,000. Means 9,000 rupees of security deposit there should be. Suppose you made a security deposit of only 5,000. Now, what you need to do? You need to pay that extra 4,000. Sir, will it be refunded to you? Yes. When, if your consumption is reduced. If your consumption is reduced and the average consumption came down to 7,000. But security deposit is how much? 9,000. Means that 2,000 will be refunded to you. You understood? This is the concept of that security deposit. Now tell me whether security deposit is taxable or non-taxable. Non-taxable, because any amount collected either as electricity or security deposit, whatever it is, everything is non-taxable because that service itself is kept in the negative list. Then point number 19. Services by selling agent of lottery ticket to distributor of lottery ticket, taxable. But who will pay service tax in this case? Distributor will pay, selling agent will not pay. Marketing agent to distributor, taxable. Who will pay? Marketing agent only will pay. Got it? It is covered under reverse charge mechanism, but it is covered under forward charge mechanism. Services by selling agent of lottery ticket to selling agent of lottery ticket, taxable. And it is covered under reverse charge mechanism. All service of selling agent of lottery is covered under reverse charge mechanism. Services by marketing agent of lottery to selling agent, taxable, and it is covered under forward charge mechanism. Professional advice by a friend to his, sir, professional advice by a person to his friend for a consideration, taxable. Consultancy service in relation to computer hardware engineering, we don't know, taxable. Technical assistance in computer software engineering, taxable. Metallurgical engineering, taxable. Professional advice to a friend, free of charge. Not a service. Non-compete fees received for not carrying on business in electrical engineering, taxable. This is what consideration for not doing an act. Admission to museum, exempted. Admission to national park, exempted. Admission to tiger reserve, exempted. Okay? So all services got over. Now listen, how you will get questions in exam? Two types of questions. Type 1, they will give list of activities and they will ask you to comment whether it is taxable or non-taxable or exempted. That is type 1. Type 2, they will give list of activities with the amounts and they will ask you to compute the service tax payable. Now what you need to do, only the taxable values you need to take separately, add it and compute the service tax. You understood or not? And for other things which you have not taken in the value, you need to write it is covered in negative list or it is in the exemption. So it is not chargeable to service tax or it is exempted from service tax. Like that you have to write the notes. So either two types of questions will be given. One is a direct one. Directly you need to write taxable or non-taxable or exempted. Another is like a question. A practical question wherein you need to arrive at the service tax payable. In that they might give credit information also. In that they might give previous year information also to consider small service provider exemption. You understood? These two service, these two types of questions. What is the weightage of this chapter, sir? That is chapter number 13, detailed analysis of services, and chapter number 14, that others, other services, abatement, etc. List, negative list of services, exempted service and abatement. Put together, you will be getting 8 marks out of these two chapters. See, I am just giving you the weightage of each and every chapter. I think chapter 11 it started, no? Service tax. Chapter 10 na, chapter 11 na? Chapter 11 only, I think. 10 na? Yeah, chapter 10. Basic aspects. Basic aspects of service tax. Then chapter 11. Valuation. chapter 12, general exemptions. Chapter 13 and 14, services, all services. Then chapter 15 is procedures. You will get 1 4 marks question from basic aspects and 1 4 marks question from valuation and 1 8 marks question from 13 and 14, that services. 8 marks means 2 4 mark questions. 2 4 marks questions. And from general exemptions, some 4 marks. And from procedures, some 4 marks. Okay, this will be the weightage. Somewhere 1 mark extra, any place it could be. Either in valuation they may ask 5 marks or in basic aspects they may ask 5 marks. Because the total of this is 24. 24 marks, anywhere 1 extra mark question could be asked and the total weightage of 25 marks. This is how it will be spread. Okay. So in service tracks, if you need to get good marks, it does not mean only selected chapters you need to read. All the chapters are equally important, but in that also first preference is this, services. Now let's proceed to the last chapter in service tracks, that is procedures under service tracks. Here if you need to know, like, whatever is the procedure, that is sufficient, because all direct questions only will be asked in this chapter. It is not like some analytical questions and all will be asked. Everything will be direct questions only. Look into page number 276. Page number 276, procedures under service tax. And there is a list in which you need to remember the procedures along with the rules. See here, in the previous page you write down rule 4. What is the first step when you wanted to pay service tax? Registration. Then you will start providing the service. Every service that you provide must be under a valid invoice. Rule 4A, invoice, bill or challan. Then all these invoices you need to preserve along with the accounting records. That is rule 5, maintenance of records. Whether you have properly maintained or not, government will check. That is known as scrutiny of records. Then once you maintain the records and you arrive at how much service tax you need to pay, you have to make payment of service tax. That is in rule 6. Payment of service tax. And finally, you need to file a return. Rule 7. Returns under service tax. That is an information document you will be filing with the government, that is known as returns under service tax. These are the basic procedures every service tax assessee will follow. Got it? These are the basic procedures which every service tax assessee will follow. You understood? You need to remember along with the rule numbers. In this, rule 6, we have already completed. What is that? Payment of service tax. Can you tell me what is the due date of payment of service tax? 6th of the month following every quarter in case of individual HUF firm including LLP, one person company whose turnover during previous year does not exceed 50 lakhs. They are covered under quarterly payment. For others it is 6th of the month following every month. And e-payment is mandatory. In case of normal payment, we need to take 5th instead of 6th. All this information is given in rule 6. Along with this, we have also discussed in Rule 6, option to pay service tax on receipt basis. Third proviso to Rule 6, Sub-Rule 1. For whom this option is there? Not professionals, individual or firm. Individual or firm. And what should be the condition? Value of taxable services provided during previous year should not exceed 50 lakhs. Current year up to 50 lakhs, they have the option either to pay service tax on receipt basis or accrual basis, that is POT basis. Once they cross 50 lakhs, they need to pay service tax only under POT basis. That is also there in Rule 6. So we completed Rule 6, okay. Then Rule 4, registration, have a look into that. Who is required to register? Let's see what is required for the purpose of exam. Lot of information is given, not everything is required. What is required for exam, we will try to understand. See this, just give a tick mark. First FAQ, who is required to register? Every person who is paying service tax is required to register. Means, a service provider who is providing non-taxable service, is he required to register? No, because he is not paying service tax. A service provider who is providing exempted services, is he required to register? No, because he is not paying service tax. A service provider who is providing abatement services, whether he need to register? Yes, because he will pay some service tax. A service provider who is providing service under reverse charge mechanism, whether he need to register? No, service recipient should get registered. You understood or not? What is the time limit for registration? Three time limits are there. Listen, please listen. Three time limits are there for registration. I have started business. I have started business. And the service what I am providing is a taxable service. Now, when I should register? Again, a classification. Am I taking SSP exemption or not taking SSP exemption? If I take SSP exemption, within 30 days after crossing 9 lakhs, I need to register. I need to make an application for registration. Suppose I have decided not to go for SSP exemption. Then within 30 days, that is after 30 days from the date of commencement, within 30 days from the date of commencement of business, I need to make application for registration. Then I started a business. And the service what I am going to provide is a non-taxable service. You understood or not? It's a non-taxable service. Then when I should register? Within 30 days from the date when such service becomes taxable. Got it? Because I don't have levy. When I don't have levy, I do not have to register. As and when this service becomes taxable, within 30 days from that date, I need to make an application for registration. Can you tell me the three time limits? On the date of commencement of business, the service is taxable and you have decided to go for SSP exemption. Then within 30 days from the date when turnover exceeds 9 lakhs in a financial year. Then number two, if the service is taxable and you have decided not to go for SSP exemption within 30 days from the date of commencement of business. Number three, on the date when you commence a business, the service is non-taxable, then within 30 days from the date when such service becomes taxable, you need to make an application for registration. Can you remember this? Then, what is the procedure for registration? This is only for our understanding, not for exam. We need to file an application for registration in Form ST1. ST stands for service tax and first form, registration, application for registration. Once they approve our application, they will be giving certificate of registration in Form ST2. ST1 is what? Application for registration. ST2, certificate of registration. Can you remember this? Form ST1? Tell her. Application for registration. ST2, certificate of registration. On certificate of registration, there will be a 15-digit code that is called as service tax registration number. First 10 digits is your permanent account number. Next 2 digits will be yes T. Last three digits will be a numeric code 001002 like this. Same as excise also. Under excise also you are having a 15 digit registration number. First 10 digits is your permanent account number. Next 2 is XM in case of manufacturer and XD in case of dealer. Last 3 will be a numeric code. You understood? Now, what if a person is required to register but he is having multiple businesses? Whether for every business he need to obtain registration or a single registration is sufficient. Single registration versus separate registration, we have both the options. Centralized registration and separate registration. While discussing excise, I discussed this point. Centralized registration means they do not want to maintain books of accounts in every place. Example, I have given MT Educare. For MT Educare, whatever the invoice that you get, you will not be seeing Chennai address, you will be seeing Mumbai address, because we have centralized registration. Got it? Separate registration means each and every business is required to register. Each and every branch we are required to register, that is separate registration. We have two options. And the service provider can decide anything, either centralized or separate. Then, what are the details that you need to furnish along with filing the application for registration? You need to give a copy of your permanent account number and the residential address, residence proof. And suppose if it is company, memorandum of association, articles of association. If it is a partnership firm, partnership deed. All these need things to be given. But in case of individual, extra is passport size photograph of the individual. Partnership not required. And for company also not required. And whether bank details we need to give? Yes. We need to give the bank details. Previously it was not there, but now we need to give the bank details. Means before application of our registration under service tax, first you need to open a bank account in the business name. Got it? You understood? Because bank details needs to be given along with the application for registration due to that reason. Then, whether verification of premises is required, just give a tick mark. For third point, you do not have to remember. Whatever we discuss, that is sufficient. Whether verification of premises is required, under excise it is mandatory. They will come and verify the premises. But under service tax it is not mandatory. If they want to come and verify, they can. And before coming, they will give a notice that we are coming for verification. You understood? Where the need for verification of premises arises, the same will have to be authorized by an officer not below the rank of ACDC. Then, when registration, ACDC stands for additional, sir, not ACDC, additional or joint commissioner, not assistant or deputy. So only the above to ACDC, they need to authorize. Okay, you go for verification. 99.99% of the cases, a service tax SSC will not be, this premises will not be verified. Registration will be granted by default. Only manufacturer's premises will be verified. Okay. Then this, very, very important for short note. When registration certificate can be revoked, when it can be cancelled, three reasons. If the premises is found to be non-existent or not in the possession of the SSE. Example, we would have stayed in one rented house and for that rented house we would have got some address proof. Using that address proof, we will obtain registration. Clear? We will vacate the house. We will go to a different location. You understood? Now, you have given the old address proof. You need to update the address proof with the service tax department, but you have not updated. You collected service tax from the clients, but you did not pay to government. Now the government will come for verification. When they see the address, in that address when they go and inquire, in that address you are not there. Immediately the registration will be suspended. Got it? Revoked. The premises are found to be non-existent or not in possession of the SSE. Second one we have discussed, not in possession of the SSE, because you are not staying in that property now. Non-existence, you have given some address. You understood? You have given some address, that is door number 888, 3rd cross, 2nd street, 4th block, 8th floor, like that some address you have given, random numbers. Nungambakkam, Chennai, 34. Where is it? No one knows. So that is known as non-existence. Such a kind of address is not in existence. Then, sir, how it can be done? Very simple. E-Aadhaar card is there. Electronic Aadhaar card. Photoshop is there. Import the E-Aadhaar card in the Photoshop. Change the address in the font, same font, and you take a color print and you give. Who will know that whether this address is correct address or false address? You understood or not? Thumb impression. For registration and all, there is no thumb impression. You understood? For getting a Jio SIM, thumb impression is required. Their address will be known. See the foolish government what it is doing. For Jio SIM and all, they are verifying the address. But registration, there is no verification of thumb impression. If you give that Aadhaar card, okay. Whether the address is correct or not, also no one is bothered. Got it? Next, no documents are received within 15 days of the date of filing the registration application. Means you filed the application, but supporting documents you have not given. That supporting documents you should give within 15 days. If you are not giving within 15 days, then also registration will be cancelled. Third, the documents are found to be incomplete or incorrect in any aspect, then also registration will be cancelled. Can you tell me the three reasons? Number one, premises not found in existence or not in the possession of the SSC. Number two, supporting documents not submitted within 15 days from the date of filing application. Number three, incomplete or incorrect documents. Incomplete or incorrect documents. In these three cases, the registration will be suspended. And this centralized registration versus separate registration already we have discussed. And transfer of business, who should obtain registration? Whether registration, special registration, separate registration is required or the same registration we can continue. You cannot continue. You have to obtain a new registration when there is a transfer of business. What about small service provider, when they need to make application for registration? After crossing 9 lakhs, within 30 days they need to make an application for registration. Then, whether an input service distributor is also required to register? Yes. Who is an input service distributor? We discussed in SenVat credit rules. Do you remember? Corporate office, branches, the corporate office will receive the service and in turn that will be used for the branches. Under SenVat credit rules we have discussed it. Okay? But don't look at me like this. We have discussed. And in that case, whether that input service distributor is required to register? Yes. Now let's see how questions will be framed on this concept. Questions not there, huh? Okay, fine. Questions are not there, but you can refer to your practice manual here. I'll tell you how questions will be. They'll give, it's like aggregate turnover of a person who commenced business during the current year is 9,01,000 as on 1/1/2017 when he need to make application for registration. Whenever he crosses 9 lakhs within 30 days, means 31/1/2017, he need to make application for registration. You understood or not? Then they will ask whether the following people are required to obtain registration. A service provider engaged in providing services only to United Nations organization. Whether they are required to register? No, because it is exempted service. Clear? So that way questions will be asked. Then the next area is invoice, bill or challan. Every service provider is required to give invoice. What is the time limit for invoice? 30 days from the date of completion of service. In case of banking and other financial services, 45 days from the date of completion of service. What if you receive advance? You have not completed service, but you received advance. Whether you need to give invoice? Yes. Same. Within 30 days or 45 days from the date of receipt of advance. 2 points you need to remember. What are those two? First, invoice to be given within 30 days from the date of completion of service or 30 days from the receipt date of receipt of payment. In case of banking and other financial services, that will be taken as 45 days. In case of air travel, the air ticket itself is treated as invoice and no separate invoice will be given. Clear? But in case of all other activities, an invoice needs to be given. For example, you travel by Ola. Immediately, once your journey is completed, you will receive to your mail a receipt. Have you seen that? That is known as invoice. So upon completion, every person needs to give invoice. Sir, the MTD care is not giving. It should give to you within 30 days from the date of completion of service.
Okay,
after the completion of batch. After the completion of batch. But in case of advance, within 30 days from the date of receipt of advance, they need to give invoice, sir. Yes. That is, whatever you pay is advance only. Correct, huh? Whether you got the invoice within 30 days from the date of payment of advance? You paid money, right? Immediately you will get a receipt. If you make by card, you will get receipt. But that is not invoice. Invoice is something different. Clearly it should have the words invoice, the fees, the breakup of service tax, entire details should be there. Whether you got such an invoice? If you have not got, you should collect it. Understood? You have to recover, get your invoice and keep it, because this much amount you have invested. Definitely you have every right to ask for invoice, get the invoice. Okay? But don't complain. Actually, it is a mistake on our part. I do agree. Because generally, a service provider, Sumoto, should give the invoice. Not on the basis of service recipient asking. But exception. In MTD care, it is exception that is happening. Then, maintenance of records. Rule 5 talks about maintenance of records. What are the records to be maintained? Mark it as very important short note question. Very important short note question. Remember 5. Rule number 5. 5 records we need to maintain for 5 years. Okay. So as per rule 5, we need to maintain 5 records for a period of 5 years. What are those 5 records we need to maintain? Listen. All records pertaining to receipt of inputs. All records pertaining to inputs. All records pertaining to capital goods. All records pertaining to input services. All records pertaining to output services. Then, along with that, other financial records. What are other financial records means? Trial balance, ledgers, profit and loss account, balance sheet, that regular financial records what you maintain. These are the 5 records to maintain. Can you tell me what are they? First, records pertaining to inputs, records pertaining to capital goods, records pertaining to input services, records pertaining to output services, and all other financial records which are required for the business. Got it? And this records to be maintained for how many years? Preserved for a period of 5 years. And when you are filing return for the first time, when you are filing return for the first time, all these records you need to submit with the superintendent. Okay, say this. Every SC shall furnish to the superintendent of central excise the above mentioned records in duplicate at the time of filing return for the first time. Then, can we have electronic records and digital invoices rather than physical? Yes, that is allowed. But all these records and the invoice should be digitally signed. There is something called digital signature. So that should be there. Then scrutiny of records, rule 5A. Rule 5 says you need to maintain records. And rule 5A says the scrutiny of records. Who will do this scrutiny? Either officer authorized by commissioner, means employee. Correct, department employee. Officer authorized by commissioner means internal. Audit party deputed by commissioner. Who is that audit party? Cost accountant or a chartered accountant? Now really it is given this way only, not the order I have changed. Order is same. Cost accountant or chartered accountant, maybe drafting error, don't blame me. Okay, why first chartered accountant did not come, sir, and why cost accountant is coming? I never intended to give this way, it was like this. Cost accountant or chartered accountant nominated under section 70. What about company secretary? No, they are not eligible for audit. Okay, next. Comptroller, listen. You are doing CS also. Who is doing? message. Comptroller and Auditor General of India. CAG. CAG. Comptroller and Auditor General can also do the scrutiny. So who are the three people eligible for scrutiny? Officer, authorized by Commissioner, audit party, that is cost accountant or chartered accountant. Number three, Comptroller and Auditor General. What are the records that they can demand for scrutiny? All the records what we have seen under Rule 5. Trial balance or its equivalent. Income tax audit report under Section 44AB. 44AB of the Income Tax Act says that every assessee, income tax assessee who crosses a prescribed turnover or gross receipts is required to get his books of accounts tax audited through a chartered accountant. And that report is known as tax audit report. Then cost audit report, if any, under Section 148 of Companies Act. But here, one foolish thing is there. To whom cost audit is applicable? Only for manufacturers. And what is it we are discussing? What is the need of cost audit report? Correct, Appa? To whom cost audit is mandatory? Manufacturers. And we are discussing about service tax. Why for a service tax see this cost audit report is required? Sir, there could be manufacturer as well as service provider. I do agree, but for them, for only manufacturing activity, cost audit is done. And service is separate. Means if you need to know anything about service, you cannot see cost audit report because cost audit report do not contain anything related to the service sector of that manufacturer. Got it? Every manufacturer might have a service business also. But that information will not be there in the cost audit. So just because chartered accountant's report is kept called income tax audit report, cost auditors also want their report to be kept in the list. That is cost audit report, if any. But otherwise, there is no use of cost audit report. What is the time limit for furnishing the records? 15 working days. Whenever they ask, within 15 working days, we need to give. Okay, we can prepare records also. No need to maintain, correct? 15 working days from the day when demand for records is made or within such further period as may be allowed by the officer or audit party. Got it? Means, whenever the notice comes for scrutiny of records, immediately we can go to the chartered accountant. Excel is there, wonderful tool. They will prepare. They will put formulas. 1 year they will put numbers. Automatically it will generate 5 years records also. You know that?
Yes,
it is nothing but formula only. All expenses increase by 20%. All incomes increase by 25%. Got it? So automatically it will compute the trial balance, profit and loss statement, balance sheet, and 5 years records can be generated. Clear or not? Then. But you should know. You should be very good at it. Templates and all you have to prepare and keep. Okay, so depending upon the SCR, even you should not, you don't need to prepare. Suppose if you Google it, templates are available. You download and keep. Whenever the person comes, ask him, it will take 15 days to complete the work. But actually it will not take 15 days, 1 day only it will take. But if you tell 1 day it is over, the fees will be less. Actually the time period to complete the work is directly proportional to the fees. If you delay, the fees will automatically increase. Clear or not? Don't do everything immediately when it comes to practice. But education, you have. Education, you have. Okay? Then, my practice is taking classes. That I cannot delay. Okay? That I have to do. So if it is with a client, yes, it will be. Because recently, I have taken up the work of your video is there. Okay. Recently, I have taken up the work for doing migration of GST. Migration of GST, my team. I have a team of people. So migration to GST means existing indirect tax records needs to be migrated to GST. And that company is IR International. It is located in a special economic zone, SIPCOT, Sriperumbatur. And it is having a head office somewhere in Spain. Okay, it's a Spain's subsidiary. They are engaged in manufacture of motor parts for foreign vehicles. And for migration, actually the work, if we see, it will be 1 day or 2 days work. 2 days we can complete the work, because all the inventory, whatever it is there, in that send VAT credit, input tax credit, like that, it will be there. These should be migrated to the new system. You understood or not? All existing things, inventory, etc., needs to be migrated to new system. Means every person will be having their own accounting software. Correct or not? So that software can be used for the purpose of migration, and one return we need to file called as GST or TRAN, GST TRAN return 1. And for this, really the work, 2 days, or even you take 3 days also. And what could be the fees that you will charge for 3 days? 3 days, what could be the fees that you will charge? You are a chartered accountant. Huh? 1 lakh? I charge 3 lakhs. I started with 5 lakhs. I started with 5 lakhs. Negotiation, and I have reduced it to 3 lakhs. But the work can be completed within a cost of 50,000 to 1 lakh. Then, sir, why are you charging? They are not my students. You understood or not? Clear? So practice is different. There are a lot of branding needs to be given. When I tell you this much information only, I cannot tell the same way to client. For client, I have to tell, so a lot of information is there. I have to do audit of ERP packages, your accounting policies needs to be verified. Lot of information, whatever you read, everything we need to dump there. So client will not understand anything. Confuse, first rule. Confuse. Once you confuse him, he will not know what needs to be done. Second, branding. Branding, what is that branding? You should carry a heavy brand when you are talking to him. And the way you speak, the confidence, everything should be great, and you should tell that I am doing it for multinational companies. Who are you? You are just one small company. But fact is, that is a big company. Number 3, inflate the fees by 500%. If you feel 1 lakh, quote 5 lakhs. Worst case, you will be ending with 2.5 lakhs. Got it? You understood or not? This is the way in which practice needs to be done. Clear? Like that, if we do teaching, you know, it will go somewhere. So we know where to do what. Got it? You understood? So therefore, practice is different. And the ideology, what you should have, should also be completely different. Sir, then don't tempt us to come for practice. I am not tempting here. Actually, it is very much tempting. There is no limit for your earnings. Really, once you start enjoying the works, practice, because employment means restricted. Monthly, this much amount of salary. And you have to work like dog from morning to evening. But what if you are independent? And that too, only you can be. An engineer cannot be like this. Only two professionals can be like this, doctor and a chartered accountant. Okay, you are blessed. When you are blessed, why should you not practice? You understood or not? So think about it. Within such further period as may be allowed. Then payment of service tax. Already we have completed this. Then look into returns. Only two things here, return and interest. With this, the procedures will be over, because this reverse charge mechanism entirely we have completed. Now, annual return, please listen, half yearly return and annual return. Annual return has been omitted now. We don't have the concept of annual return under service tax. It got omitted. So all this information you do not have to read. Only this half yearly return. Then why you have given this in the book, sir? At the time when I have given, it was there, and later on it is omitted. Okay. Half yearly return means the name itself says you have to file 2 returns in a year. What is the first half year? I know the first half year, April to September. For this April to September, the due date is 25th of October. 25th of the month following the half year, you need to file that return. Next half year is October to March, you need to file that return by April 25th, not March 31st. Not March 31st, April 25th. Now, can this return be filed belatedly? Yes. Yes, and there is a late fee. What is that late fee? If the delay is up to 15 days, the late fee is 500. If the delay is 30 days, the late fee is 1000. If the delay is beyond 30 days, semi-variable cost, 1000 rupees plus 100 rupees for every day during which the delay continues, subject to a maximum of 20,000 rupees. For example, if the delay is 200 days, how much will be the penalty? For 30 days, it is 1000. So, 200 minus 30, 180. 180, sorry, 170. 170 into 100, 17,000 plus 1000, 18,000 will be the penalty. What if the delay is 300 days? Maximum 20,000 will be applicable. You understood? That is the late fee. Then, can the return be revised? Yes. And under excise, we have seen that you should file on or before the due date, then only it can be revised. But under service tax, even if you file the return belatedly, you can revise it. From when you can revise? 90 days from the due date or date of filing return. Date of filing return. So what is the time limit for revision in return? 90 days from the date of filing the return. But sad that in GST there is no concept of revision in returns. Okay, so with service tax it will be over. Revision in returns, excise and service tax. Under GST there is no revision. It is only adjustment in the next return. Some mistake you did in the previous return, you can't do anything. You have to file in a new return by making adjustments to the previous return. Got it? Then interest, please see, there are three types of interest. Just rate alone you need to know, and when which rate will be applicable. Please listen here. You have to pay service tax. You have to collect service tax. You collected it. You have to collect service tax. You collected it. But you have not paid it. Understood? In that case, the interest is computed at the rate of 15% per annum, 15% per annum for the period of delay. Simple interest only, not compounding interest. Simple interest only. For example, I have to collect service tax and I collected 10,000 as service tax. I have to pay it by 6th of July, but I paid it on 28th of September. Now, from 6th of July, from 7th of July, 6th due date, I have not paid. From 7th of July to 28th of September, I need to calculate the interest. You understood or not? Means how much? 10,000 rupees into 15% into delay period. Some days, number of days divided by 365, PTR by 100, okay? Same way I need to calculate interest, simple interest only. What will be the rate of interest? 15%. Clear? Next. Listen. I need to collect some service tax, but I collected excess service tax. You understood? I need to collect some service tax, but I collected excess service tax. When it will be applicable? Say, there is a reduced rate applicable for me. Abatement is applicable for me. And the effective rate of service tax is 6%. But I am collecting from the client 15%. But I pay only 6%. You understood? Actually, the rate applicable to me is 6%. But how much I am collecting from the customer? 15. But how much I am paying? 6. This is amount collected in excess of the service tax. Correct or not? In this case, if that excess I am not paying, then also the rate will be 15%. Interest will be 15%. The same way it should be computed. Got it? That is amount of service tax collected in excess into 15% into period of delay divided by 365 days. But while computing the period of delay, I need to take it as first day from the first day of the month succeeding the month in which tax ought to have been paid. What is the due date? 6th July. In our example, 6th July is the due date. But I have not paid. That excess amount I have not paid. From when I need to calculate interest? 7th July or 1st August? 1st August. Because the words used are from the first day of the man succeeding the man in which the amount ought to have been paid till the date of payment of such amount. Understood or not? So for this period we need to compute interest. And what is the rate of interest? 15%. There are two places we have got 15% rate of interest. And tell me what is the difference when it is applicable. To be collected but not paid. In that case, 15% from the next day of the due date till the actual date of payment. Second, collected in excess and not paid. Here also 15% from the first day of the month succeeding the month in which there is due date till the actual date of payment. Third, serious case. You are not required to collect, but you collected. You are availing SSP exemption and you are not supposed to collect service tax, but you collected and you have not paid. In this case, the interest is 24% per annum. Interest rate is how much? 24% per annum from the first day after the due date. First day after the due date till the actual date of payment. Collection of any amount as service tax. Collection of any amount as service tax means actually it is not service tax. Some amount you collected as service tax, but failing to pay the amount so collected to the government on or before the due date. Then what is this? Amount collected in excess of the tax. You understood or not? Sir, extra if you collect, this case. You are not at all supposed to collect, but collected and paid 24%. You are supposed to collect and collected but not paid 15%. And the period will differ. Can you remember this? Okay. Now, in these three interest rates, 15, 15 and 24, three points we discussed, we have a discount offer. 3% discount is available. When? If the value of taxable services provided during previous year does not exceed 60 lakhs, we have a discount of 3%. Means what will be the effective rate of interest in that case? 12%, 12% and 24 will become 21%. Understood? So this is about the interest provisions. So with this, entire service tax we have completed. Okay? And in the next class, we will be starting with customs.